Welcome back to the Album Waiting Hour YouTube channel, the home of album reviews, discography guides and think pieces. So today's review is a review of the brand new collaborative album between Bobby Gillespie and Jehnny Beth called Utopian Ashes. Now, as for my experience with both artists, Bobby Gillespie I'm obviously familiar with through his work with Primal Scream, specifically the album Screamadelica, one of the greatest albums of all time, as well as Evil Heat and XTRMNTR, although I have to admit I haven't really got much further into their discography aside from those three albums. And Jehnny Beth, while I haven't really listened to any of her work thus far apart from this album, I was definitely aware of her very positive reputation within the modern music community, so I had no reason going into this not to be excited, because you have Bobby Gillespie of Primal Scream, one of the biggest rock bands in the last 30 years arguably, colliding with Jehnny Beth, somebody who has, like I said, a very positive reputation coming from quite a new career, and so she obviously has a lot of her career ahead of her to do stuff like this. And you know, so this is obviously a massive crossover, so like I've already said, I had no reason to go into it and not be incredibly excited. So I sat down and here's what I thought of Jehnny Beth's and Bobby Gillespie's new collaborative album, Utopian Ashes. The opening track, Chase It Down, is definitely a defining opening statement, because I really like the ways the acoustic guitars and the strings mix in the intro. I think the instrumental is really good overall, actually, because I like the very nice touches of organ throughout the instrumental. I think the drum has a very solid groove to it, although sounding slightly dry, and that's a problem that will come up once or twice throughout this album. But I mean, not many people really care how dry or plain their drums sound on an album, but to me it kind of stuck out a little bit like a sore thumb, but it's not like massively noticeable. It's just like a bit kind of, oh, they're a bit sort of plain, aren't they? But it's not too much to worry about. And I think Bobby sounds quite good on the verses. I like when he kind of reaches up into his higher register on songs like these, and I think he sounds overall decent. When the chorus hits though, that is really where it's at, because the instrumental in the verse is complemented by these really nice sharp stabs of strings, which are complemented by these nice tambourine hits, and Jehnny Beth's vocals on this are great. I think it really complements the kind of rocking, dramatic, catchy sound that the track has going for it, and I think that they absolutely drive that home with this song, because to me it sounds like a just really classic rocking Primal Scream track if I had to draw on any immediate influence. I will say that I think the guitar solo around maybe 3 minutes ish ruins it slightly, because I think although it is fairly dramatic and rocking, I think the addition of a guitar solo kind of disrupts the vibe a little bit, if you want to say it that way, and I think that it maybe could have done without it. But apart from that, this is a very solid opener. The next track is English Town, and while I will say that I'm not a massive fan of the drums on this track at all, because I don't like this kind of brush style of drumming, I guess, that he goes for. I don't know what the term for it would be, but like, I think you get what I mean. But I do think that the guitars sound fairly nice, and I think that the vocals and the pianos sound incredible on this track. But really, if I had to boil it down to it, the sound of this track is really just a bit too kind of just there, if you got what I mean. Like, it's pleasant enough, but I just don't think it works within the format that it's in as a kind of slower, moodier rock track. Although, I will add the caveat that if this was just a piano ballad with just like vocals, pianos, and maybe some extra synthesizers, that would be incredible to me, because I think the way the vocals and the piano mix, especially in the chorus, sounds incredible. I think the flourishes of synths are really nice as well. So I think if this track was kind of stripped down a little bit to just like piano, vocals, and maybe synthesizers, it would have worked a lot better. But with the addition of guitars and drums along with that, to put it in a more standard rock format, it kind of loses a little bit of its spark for me, because again, it just seems a bit meh. Like, yeah, the pianos and vocals are nice, but everything else around it is just very nondescript, and it's a bit of a shame, because like I say, some elements of this track are absolutely fantastic. Next track is called Remember We Were Lovers, and to my ears this really just sounds like generic ballad fodder. Like, I don't really see the appeal of this. Like, I get that it's trying to go for that kind of forlorn moody sound, but you can tell that from its opening seconds, because, like, you know, the washed out reverby drums, the organs, the pianos, it all seems very, very obvious. Like, this track, more than any, now that I'm realizing it, just sounds like a load of people in a room going, what does a ballad sound like, and then just trying to do that, because it's a collaborations record, there's obviously going to be one or two ballads in there just to balance things out, but it just doesn't work in my opinion. Like, the drums sound really boring, the pianos and organs aren't anywhere near as distinctive as they have been on the past two tracks. I mean, I guess the bass and vocals are fairly nice enough, but, you know, this track just seemed very, very generic, and you can tell that they were trying to go for a kind of, you know, anthemic, moody love song, because they put this out as a single, and so I guess they were obviously trying to kind of go, oh, you know, this is going to be versatile, like, yeah, we can do rock tracks like Chase It Down, but we can also do ballad tracks and blah, 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 blah. But at least if you're going to try and do a ballad track, just do it better, really, because you've already shown that you can do stuff like you've done before, like with Chase It Down having the Primal Scream influence, while still having your own unique take on it, whereas this just sounds like some people who are already in rock bands trying to do a ballad and doing the very bare minimum to do that, and there's nothing really much to this track beyond that, in my opinion, because again, it just sounds very, very boilerplate, very nondescript, and just very, very generic and boring, so I wouldn't really give this track a listen if I was you. But then we get to track 4, Your Heart Will Always Be Broken, and the quality level shoots right back up, because I love this song. I think the guitars, the organs and the pianos in the intro and throughout the song really complement each other incredibly well. I think Jehnny's vocals are pretty good, but definitely are better when her vocals kind of go up in intensity levels, kind of in the pre-chorus, I guess you would say. And the chorus on this is an absolute earworm. Like, yes, it is a more ballad type track, so it's a bit slower, but I really do like the way the chorus sounds on this. I think Bobby's verse is fairly nice, but there's something up with his vocals, because on the second chorus to this thing, after the chorus finishes, he has like his own solo vocal bit on the last line, and it kind of sounds like his vocals have been auto-tuned. I mean, I'm not sure if they have, but something about the cadence of his voice just sounds really, really weird. But I think it is really a case of the chorus and the instrumental absolutely stealing the show, because this instrumental, everything within it complements one another, and I actually quite like how sad and forlorn and dramatic it is, because it does that style brilliantly, in my opinion, because it's not so overproduced that you think they're trying too hard, but it's not reaching that point that I've had critiques of this album so far where it just kind of sounds really dry. It actually sounds quite lush, and at points even quite like ethereal and even kind of, you know, very relaxing, I would say, overall. And I think that the chorus on this, again, is an absolute earworm. And yes, well, honestly, I wouldn't really have a problem with the track's runtime being cut in half, given that it basically just meanders for the last 2.5 minutes of its runtime. But to be fair, given that the core of the track is so solid, I can't really fault it too much, because just, again, the core of this track is absolutely incredible. So again, while it does flounder in its last few minutes, I do think that this track is a case of a song that knows what style it's going for and does that style absolutely brilliantly. And in my opinion, this is easily the best track on the whole album. Track 5 is Stones of Silence, and is honestly quite a mixed bag, because while I do like the verse on this, I think the electric pianos and the bass sound pretty nice, and I do think that the touch of like kind of Latin-esque percussion really complements Jehnny's vocals quite well, if I'm honest. But I do think that the chorus is a little bit of a letdown. Like, it's kind of as if it's building up to the chorus, but then when the chorus hits, there's not really much of an uptake in intensity or like energy or just anything. It just sort of happens. Like, you know, it's like, okay, building up to chorus, and like, it's just very, it's less of an explosion and more like a fart, really, is all I can describe it. Like, it's very, very underwhelming as a chorus. Like, it doesn't have any impact, really. It doesn't there's not really much of a memorable hook here, really. I mean, the vocals are all right, I suppose, but there's nothing mind-blowing going on here. And, you know, I do think the guitar solo is all right, but I think overall, this track is just a really mixed bag, because it seems like it's going for kind of a weird mix of styles as well. Like, the electric pianos make it sound kind of soul-influenced, but then, like, the guitars and the percussion make it sound a little bit Latin, but then the chorus is, like, acoustic, uplifting indie rock. Like, it just seems like a bit of a weird mishmash of styles that doesn't really go over too well. Like, I think the verse is all right, but I just think that the chorus is a little bit of a letdown, and when you've got a really a quite decent verse but not a very decent chorus, it kind of ends up being a bit of a weird mismatch, because if I could listen to half a song then I would, but I don't really see much point in that. Track 6 is You Don't Know What Love Is, and is another piece of very generic ballad fodder. Because I really don't understand it. Like, the way the guitars and the pianos mix, like, they mix fine, but there's just no defining characteristics to them whatsoever. Like, if you said, oh, pick out a defining characteristic about this song, I really couldn't do it, because instrumentally it's boring, and vocally, if you talk about just a vocal performance or from a songwriting standpoint, the vocals just sound really flat and boring, and even quite monotone at points, even in the chorus, because I never thought I would have to describe the chorus to a song as monotone, but they just sound like they're bored out of their minds, like nothing interesting is going on here. And I think the strings that are added in this track, I think they sound absolutely weird and horrendous on the second verse, and overall, even when they are better, like in the pre-chorus, it just sounds like they're tacked on. Like, again, it's kind of like the same problem with Remember We Were Lovers, where they're just like, okay, it's a duos album, so obviously they're gonna want some duets, some ballads, what can we do? We've done the kind of weird, kind of smoky, moody ballad, and the kind of generic, kind of organ-backed ballad. Let's just, guitars, pianos, even more boring, let's do that. Like, it sounds like they're trying to come up with like an even mix of rockier songs and more ballad-like songs, but they're just running out of ideas for one way quicker than they are for the other, so you can almost like see that mismatch happening in real time, and it's kind of an odd sensation, and not one which I really like particularly. You don't know. The next song is called You Can Trust Me Now, which is a bit of an odd one, because it starts off with a 25 second long spoken word intro from Bobby Gillespie, which sounds okay, I suppose, but it's just kind of really weird and off-putting, because this is, let's face it, for all intents and purposes, a fairly straightforward, very kind of normal rock album, and not to say that can't be done well at points, because obviously it has, but I mean, let's be fair, it's a fairly normal rock album sound wise so I didn't think that I would have to, like, I'd get into track 7 of this thing and all of a sudden I'd be like exposed to some weird spoken word passage, but I mean, it's all right, I suppose. I mean, there's not really much I can say about it, but then the transition between that and the actual song itself is really weird, because it's almost as if they recorded the two separately and put them in the same, like, project file, but left, like, a second and a half of silence in between the two clips, so, like, the transition between them is really abrupt. I actually realised while editing this that if you look on every version of this album, apart from the ones they put on streaming services, they are actually listed as different tracks, as in the spoken word intro and the actual song itself are listed as different tracks, which, if anything, confuses me even more, because surely if they're listed as different tracks on the physical release, they'd be listed as different tracks on the streaming release. So if anything, the critique I had of it was 100% correct, and like I said, it just confuses me even more, because why wouldn't they just be separate tracks? But I don't know. And for the song itself, I don't think it sounds too bad with the pianos and the strings in the intro, but when it gets joined by the guitars and the drums, something just sounds a little bit off to me. Like, it's not bland per se, but I think just the mix of, like, just the way the piano and the strings and the guitars and the drums blend together, it's not like other previous tracks where it sounds like they're all kind of working together as a cohesive unit in terms of an instrumental. It kind of sounds like the piano and the strings are one thing and the guitars and the drums are another thing, and they're just kind of smashing the two together and they don't really work too well. I think the string breakdown in the bridge is kind of weird, and I do think that the chorus is, again, weirdly boring. Like, why are your choruses boring? If anything, this should be the most exciting part of most of these songs, but the past few have just been unbelievably mediocre. The penultimate track is called Living a Lie, and to start with the instrumental, it's very bland again. Like, the drums are really dry and plain, the guitars don't really have anything interesting going on with them, the bass is a little too loud. Like, it's just a very generic, boring, more slow-paced rock-style instrumental. But then, what the absolute genius engineers decided to do is go, I know that this instrumental maybe sounds a little bit boring, but I know what'll make it sound better. Harps. Yes, you heard me right. There are harps on this song. And it doesn't even sound as though they got an actual, like, you know, good professional harp player in the studio to play some stuff. It literally sounds like they got harp stock sound effects off the internet and just layered it over the track. And it's really annoying because they picked this really kind of oddly low quality, boring, like 3 second loop of harp and just kind of loop that over and over and over again, and it sounds really, really annoying. Moving on to the rest of the track, I think the vocals in Bobby's verse are performed fairly well, and I do think the chorus is actually alright, although I do have a slight problem with it, given that I'm not really sure how to say it, but it's almost as if the chorus thinks it's grander than it is, if you got what I mean. Like, I get what it's trying to go for with the, like, stomping beat and the trumpets in the background and the vocal delivery. Like, I get it's trying to go for this really uplifting, bombastic chorus, but because this album is just quite dry and quite plain sounding, and there's not really much oomph behind anything, it tries to be really bombastic and energetic and kind of uplifting, but then it just isn't, and it just kind of ends up falling flat on his face, which is a bit of a shame, to be honest. And then you get onto Jehnny's verse, or the first of her verses, and it's really weird, because she goes for this odd kind of whispering delivery, which kind of creeps me out a little bit, I'm going to be honest. And the lyrics, I get, it kind of about a dysfunctional relationship and not wanting to carry on with it because you obviously aren't compatible, but the way she kind of phrases it within the lyrics, obviously because it's spoken word as well, it just comes across as very kind of ham-fisted and a bit odd, and that's the same with her next verse as well after the other chorus. But I think it's just a case of a track really desperately trying hard to differentiate itself, but all the ways it tries to go about doing that just fall flat on their face. Like, they've got a fairly standard rock track, but the ways they try to go about improving it by, like, adding harps or the attempt at a more bombastic chorus or the spoken word vocals, it all just ends up falling flat on its face. And so I kind of commend them for trying, but at the same time, I'm like, why did you try? Because when you do try, it doesn't sound very good. In fact, I'd argue it sounds better when you don't try, which is oddly the antithesis of basically everything I've already said in this review, but I think in context of this track, it makes a lot of sense. The final track is called Sunk in Reverie. And this is honestly a very disappointing way to end off the album, because again, it's just another very generic track. Like, the guitar strumming and the bass, again, very plain. The vocals are okay, I guess, but there's really nothing to dissect here at a deeper level if you're trying to actually go in and review the thing, because there's just not really anything there. And there are also a few weird mixing decisions on this track that I don't quite understand, because for one, the bass is a lot too loud for my taste. Like, it was a bit loud on the last track, but it seems as though to compensate for the lack of instruments in this track, they just turn the bass up and it sounds a bit odd. And then when the, like, pianos and synths and organs get introduced, they're only on the right channel for some reason, which I don't understand why that, like, what, who, why is that a choice that you make? Like, yeah, everything else, that's going to be, like, in stereo, but, like, with the synthesizers and the pianos, nah, just put them on the right channel, it's fine. Like, what's the rationale behind this? I really don't understand. And, like, what is it? The piano solo, I suppose, is quite nice, despite how kind of out of nowhere it is, because the track, again, sounds very plain, but, like, the piano is quite reverbed and quite grand, so it just kind of comes out of nowhere. And I think the same could be said for the lyrics on the verse after the piano solo, which get really kind of sexual and weird for no reason whatsoever out of nowhere. Like, I haven't really been paying attention to the lyrics very much at all throughout this album, because they're just very nondescript. But like, I'm just kind of listening along to this very plain song, and then all of a sudden Bobby Gillespie is talking about having sex with somebody for some reason, and I'm just like, whoa, hang on a minute, where the hell did this come from?
Another note that I should probably add is that I read in a Pitchfork article about this album that it's actually supposed to be somewhat of a concept album about a couple that have either gone through or are going through some kind of separation or divorce or that kind of thing. And I guess that does make the kind of weirdly sexual lyrics make a bit more sense. But in that case, like, why isn't this more of a kind of upfront concept? Like, it doesn't make nearly as much of an effort as I think it should do to make that concept obvious to you right from the outset, or even making some like remote effort to make itself obvious to you that it even is a concept album in the first place, and so it just comes off like confusing and awkward.
And again, it's just a bit like the last track where everything just kind of feels a bit disjointed with one another. Like, you've got very plain instrumental, synthesizers and pianos only on one channel, a really grand piano solo after the second chorus, oddly sexual lyrics. Like, it's just, again, it seems like a bit of a weird melting pot, and where nothing really complements each other or works with one another. Just everything is just kind of thrown onto the track, and then nobody really cares as to whether it works as a track. They just kind of throw what they have down onto the tape and just kind of leave that as is. And so you get songs like this, which are so weirdly mixed that honestly, I don't really know how to comment on this, because it's not really bland, because there are too many details that are not bland for me to talk about, but it's not really interesting either, so I'm just kind of left scratching my head for 4 minutes, and then the album's over. Oh, how are you so polite? Hello. So, what did I think of Bobby Gillespie and Jehnny Beth's collaborative album, Utopian Ashes? Well, I'll just say this much. Despite a few highlights on the front end, this thing is really not worth your time. Like, there are maybe two or three good songs, and those are all in the first four songs, and then basically everything after that is just some of the most painfully bland rock music I've heard in quite a while. And honestly, I'd say that if you're trying to get into either of these artists, don't bother going with this album, because it is just so cookie cutter and boring. And that's a shame, because like I said in the intro, two names of this size coming together could have been something really great. And it's a shame, because I'm quite a big fan of the Primal Scream albums I've heard, and no doubt I would be a big fan of the other ones that I have not yet heard. And honestly, I'm quite intrigued by what Jehnny Beth does with Savages, and also in her own solo work as well. So for this album to be as painfully generic and at points as weird as it is quite a massive letdown, because this was, if anything, one of my most anticipated releases of this year. And so for it to come out as one of the most generic and plain albums I think I've heard this year, if not the most generic and plain album I've heard this year, I cannot tell you how disappointed I am. So all things considered, I can't really give it anything more than really a light 5.
Actually, I've decided since that it's a bit worse than that, so I'm probably going to settle on a decent 4 for this one.
So I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, please consider giving it a like, and also maybe subscribing if you feel like it. This is really the end of the kind of flurry of uploads that I've been doing, because I just wanted to get enough videos out so that I can be uploading them while I'm not able to film. So then there's not as much of a gap between uploads as there normally would be. So hopefully this has been enough to kind of tide you over to my next big review, which will be an album review, and I am honestly quite excited for it. So keep your eyes peeled for that. And again, I hope you enjoyed the video, and I will see you all later.